Dear participants and viewers, Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to all in our live online international webinar, Volume 3, presented by Independent Perception and Research Hub, Bangladesh. This is an educational public webinar, so each and every person feel free to join with us. Independent Perception and Research Hub is an educational research and consultation center for the talent researcher and educational scholar for sharing their perception on different issues and facts. The main goal of IPRH is enlightening the independent perception of individual thoughts by the knowledge sharing, providing research news and training, and also brainstorming and research project consultation with innovative ideas, and organize talk show with different research person from different area around the world. So interested to research scholar are most welcome to join with IPRH and share your innovative ideas and research and contribute to the society and the world as a whole. Because IPRH always believes that knowledge is power. Our today's theme for the International Online Webinar Volume 3 is the dimension of digital marketing insights. Digital marketing is the component of marketing that users use the internet and online-based digital technologies such as desktop, computer, mobile phones, and other digital medias and platform to promote the product and services. It's developed during 1990s, and after that in 2000, it is changed the way of brands and business use technology for marketing. As digital chains platform become increasingly incorporated into marketing plans and everyday life, and as people use digital devices instead of visiting physical shops, digital marketing campaigns have become the prevalent, employing the combination of search engine marketing, content marketing, influencer marketing, e-commerce marketing, social media marketing, social media optimization, email direct marketing, and display advertising, e-book, option, disc, and game have become the commonplaces. Digital marketing extends to non-internet channel also that provides the digital media such as television, mobile phones, and etc. So, dear viewers, today we have our five international expert resource person or guest speaker who are expert on digital marketing era. And those who are Dr. Rabia Bhatia, international speaker, mompreneur and edupreneur, research fellow of IPRH, and today she will speak on the topic of importance of digital learning. We have with us Professor Muhammad Johiruddin Arif, Department of Marketing, Jagannath University, Bangladesh, advisor and academic council member, Global University, Bangladesh. Today, he will share the concept of the digital marketing, a new dimension for startup business development. We have with us Ravindra Thiran from Sri Lanka, research fellow of IPRH, and he will discuss about the improving management skill in digital education system. We have with us Professor Dr. Mario, founder and chairman Lead Philippines, global speaker and academician. He will describe the concept of digital learning in the academy. And after all, we have our webinar chair and discussant, Advocate Raimunnesa Begum, advocate and academician from India and research fellow of IPRH, and she will discuss about the concept of the legislation of digital marketing, that is the digital marketing in a legal safeguard. So, dear viewers and attendees, please fill up your registration form for your e-certificate. And we have already 500 registered participants for this webinar. And feel free, you also able to fill up your registration form in the meantime of the webinar. So, please let's welcome our first guest speaker, Dr. Rabia Bhatia, for her concept on the importance of digital learning.
Good evening all, and good evening sir. Thank you so much for inviting me on this wonderful platform of Independent Perception and Research Hub. I'm glad to be honored as a, you know, keynote speaker between so wonderful dignitaries from one across the globe, actually. So it's a great honor for me. Thanks once again. And yes, wonderful.
Yes, ma'am. Wonderful topic. The floor is yours. So please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you once again. And yes, a wonderful topic we have chosen, the digital marketing, digital learning. I think digital, we have become very much digital. Yes, for sure. Before the lockdown, before the pandemic, we were never digital. We were only using the digital media, social media for refreshing our minds, for chit-chatting with our friends and connecting with the families. There were hardly any professional platforms digitally where we were actually connecting with the, you know, like-minded people and for professionals. For example, one of the platform, most important platform is the LinkedIn platform. However, thanks to lockdown, thanks to COVID positive, thanks to pandemic, that we have started using Facebook, Pin, we have started using Insta, Twitter for all our professional purposes. Digital learning. Now, I would like to add very basic points here. You know, digitally, we are equipped across the globe, people, whether if they are students, whether they are kids, whether they are grandparents, senior citizens. To be honest, the lockdown gave us ample of opportunities where we could learn from each other how to become independent and how to use digital applications for our own growth, whether it was individual growth or a team growth, whether we were growing personally or professionally, whether it was our grandparents or our extended families or our small kids, early year kids and teenagers, or for example, you know, 10 to 12 years to students, everybody grew in their own possible way when it comes to the digital learning. Thanks to digital learning, I would rather say that the learning never stopped. The learning never stopped. The education never stopped, whether it was for the learner or it was for the educators or for the professionals. Before the lockdown, we were meeting everyone physically, and we were able to go and meet people, meet and greet people physically. To, you know, to some extent, to some of the, you know, maybe our 5 kilometer radius of our own houses, 5 kilometer radius of our own offices, 10 kilometer of our own offices, or 10 kilometer radius of our own city wise, actually, and country, traveling from one country to another country. There were hardly any occasions or there were hardly any events when we were able to attend the offline events across the globe. But thanks to this lockdown once again, lockdown, I know the pandemic has been a, you know, a major has affected us in a bad shape. We economically across the globe, we have actually dipped down. But having said that, we have grown digitally. We have grown technically. We have understood the concept of technicalities of social media, technicalities of YouTube, technicalities of LinkedIn, technicalities of Insta, how to use these platforms in a professional way. We got so many applications when it comes to digital learning. We got to know gamification. We got to know Flipgrid. We got to know Flipgrid learning from wonderful places, wonderful applications came into picture. And the students started enjoying their online learning classes because as educators, it wasn't the, you know, it wasn't our objective to just give a lecture and finish up the class. No, it was never the motto. The motto was to make our students joyful, to make our students understand the realities of digital learning, understand the how to use technical applications, computers in a better way, the best way in order to grow and in order to learn, basically. Not only, you know, to pass on the knowledge, but to grab that knowledge. It was very much focused, actually. Now, the thing is, having said that, I have shared many good points about digital learning, but actually, there were instances when the digital media during the lockdown also was used in such a way where there was a cybersecurity issues. You know, when there are cybersecurity issues, when there are cyber crimes happening, we need to understand, we need to make sure what group we need to join, what kind of people we need to add to our professional purpose, what kind of people we need to add to our networking. Maybe many of us are educators, but the mentality is still the same. Especially not, I would not say that across the globe people, the mentality is still the same. But yes, there are some areas, the corners of some world where, you know, there were cyber crimes happening because of this huge usage of social media. And there were embarrassments for the women. There were embarrassments for the teenagers. And it's not that I would not say that it was only because the men were doing or women were not, and women were the culprit, women were the victims. No, it is not. It was vice versa as well. So there were women also who were the culprits, and there were men also who were the culprits. So we need to understand how to make the best usage and how to connect with the like-minded people so that we can understand the privacy issues, we can understand the safety and security issues of an individual as well. So digital learning has, if there are lot of pros and of digital learning, there equally there are cons as well. We always say that there are benefits also and there are negative points as well. So digital learning, if there are benefits, there are negativity as well. There is negativity, lot of negativity. People started spreading lot of negativity about COVID positive. The other people who were actually taking the online sessions or who were actually able to connect with those people, they got demotivated. So digital learning, when it comes to digital learning, it's not only the education has to come into picture. There are a lot of things that comes into picture. The like-minded people, networking with the people who are actually there in your support, who are actually supportive enough, who are there to motivate you, encourage you, and make you independent and make you happy also at the same point of time. You know, digital learning at times, we got overboard with it. There was a time because of the fact that we are still in pandemic. It's not yet over. And these online sessions got so much that everybody started getting into the online sessions. I think that we were doing more than 5 sessions in a day. And it wasn't good enough also. We need to understand what session we need to take, how to use the digital platforms in a better way in order to have a mental health in place, in order to have a physical health in place. So importance of digital learning, I would like to say here, first most important thing is make it joyful, make it motivational, make it encouraging so that the other people who are actually viewing the sessions should feel happy and satisfied and they are ready to join the next session. They should not feel demotivated. we need to make sure that the class or the lecture or the sessions we are giving to the students, it should be very joyful. The students should feel happy after taking the sessions, and they should be able to learn from that session. Not only passing the knowledge to the session to the students is enough, but we need to understand the psychology, the mindset of a student, whether they are in a position to grab that knowledge, whether they are ready to take that session on that particular day. These things come into picture when it comes to the digital learning. We made ourselves approachable. As educators, we need to be approachable, not only for our students, but for our families, for our colleagues, for our employees as well. Whether we are professionals or educators, whether we are working in an education sector or we are working as an entrepreneur and we're working in corporate, the importance of digital learning comes into picture and is beneficial only when we are approachable enough to the other person. We are there to support each other. Be compassionate, be empathetic. Not only, I know many of us are, entrepreneurs, and many of us are the leaders and the founders and the chairmen of multinational organizations. But as a leader, we need to understand that these digital platforms are there to support your employees and not to make them work under pressure. This is very much important when it comes to the importance of digital learning, because of the fact we need to make sure that your employee is have a work-life balance. We need to, there were times before the lockdown when we used to discuss about work-life balance so that we can have the, Saturday, Sunday's week off or a Friday, Saturday week off, and at the same point of time, 4 to 5 days working. So the same applies during the digital learning as well. No matter what difference does it make that we are working from home or we are working from office, we are still sitting in front of the laptop, we are still working in front from 9 to 6 shift or 10 to 5 shift, whatever the timings are. We are still giving the same timing to the office, to our work. So it is very important to make our employees comfortable enough so that they can take a break, they can take rest, mental rest, physical rest, at the same point of time, they are giving the 100% productivity. So digital learning, importance of digital learning comes into picture when these things are equally balanced. So it is not only that, yes, we always keep our employees at work if they are working from home. That's not the issue. That's not the challenge. The challenge is they are still working for you. And similar thing goes for the students, for our students as well. They are still studying, right? We have to make them understand that digital platforms are there to support you and not to give them pressure. Only then the learning will never stop. Only then they will be able to, grab the knowledge in the best possible way. It is very important to understand the security and safety of our employees, safety and security of our kids, safety and security of our, people working along with us. Now, digital learning, this lockdown gave us the opportunity to collaborate with the people across the globe with some great professionals. But at the same point of time, there were things happening which should not happen socially. Social media is there to connect with people who can support you. Once again, I would like to stay here. It is very important to support each other, be compassionate, not to demotivate them, not to make them embarrassed, and not to, interfere in their personal lives. There were issues happening. We as leaders, we as professionals are very much aware of what was happening across the globe and what is still happening. This thing needs to be stopped. Until the time we are not able to change ourselves, we will not be able to make sure that the other person changes. So the change starts from you yourself. If we are ready to change, only then we can bring the change in the world. It is very much important that digital learning is happening to be compassionate and to support each other for bringing the global peace. We all are working towards sustainability somewhere. And that sustainability will only come in when we collaborate with like-minded people with the mindset of changing the society, of bringing the change in the society, whether we are using digital platforms or we are meeting them offline. It is very much important to make them understand that social media has to be used in a good and beneficial way, and not to harass somebody's life, not to harass somebody's mental health, not to harass somebody's physical health. At the same point of time, thanks to pandemic once again, that the students, that the grandchildren were able to help their grandparents how to use these digital platforms to enjoy their own life. We were all trapped at our houses. We are still trapped. We are not able to go much outside our homes till now, because thanks to this Omicron, the new brand of, I won't say the new variant, but it is a new brand of COVID-19. Because till the time, we will keep saying that it is a new variant. It will keep demotivating us. It will keep discouraging us. So let's not spread negativity. Let's spread positivity through these digital platforms. Omicron is fair enough. Let us have that courage to fight on once again. Life is full of ups and downs. Life is full of challenges. Whatever comes in front of you, we need to make sure that we are ready to face that challenge and we are able to overcome this challenge, actually. And that is how we'll be able to help each other and support each other. So thanks to this lockdown, where grandchildren made their grandparents understand how to use Facebook, how to use YouTube to listen to some kirtan, bhajan, some song, some music, actually. So the digital learning was not only for the students, not only for the youngsters, but for the seniors as well, for the elders as well. So if there are benefits, there are some negatives as well. That is something we need to change as a individual, as a good human being. Only then we'll be able to bring happiness in someone else's life. And yes, when we bring happiness and smiles in someone else's life, we ourselves get happy and we ourselves get encouraged and motivated. So that is all I would like to say here. To sum up, digital learning is a beautiful learning platforms. We need to understand that these platforms should be used wisely and only to help people and support people and to, pass on the correct kind of knowledge and not for the cyber crimes. That's all I would like to say here. Thank you so much, sir, once again, Mr. Parvez, for inviting me on this wonderful platform among so many wonderful leaders across the globe.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Rabia. You have the wonderful thoughts on the digital learning, and it's really helpful for our society. And IPRS thanks you and hope that you will join our future webinar when we invite you again. So thank you now. Dear viewers, if you have any kinds of question, feel free to ask your question in the comment box. Mention your speaker name, your name, your current job status. Our resource speaker will answer your question at the end of this session. Now is the time to invite Professor Mohammad Johiruddin Arif, Department of Marketing, Jagannath University, Bangladesh, Advisor and Academic Council Member, Global University, Bangladesh. And today, sir, will share with us the concept of digital marketing, a new dimension for startup business development. So, sir, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Professor Mohammad Shahriyar Parvez, CEO IPRS, and thanks to organizer Independent Perception and Research Hub, and distinguished keynote speakers for today's international webinar organized by this research organization. And I would like to share my PPT.
Yes, sir. Possible from yes, here? Yes, 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 sir. You just share it from your side.
Okay. Share screen, okay?
Yes, sir.
Share screen. do not show this.
Yes, sir.
Is
it is
finished
visible
showing?
Now. Yes,
visible.
It is visible. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, today's international webinar on dimension of
sir,
digital
just,
marketing.
Click on the slideshow, sir. On
okay.
The slideshow, yes.
It's okay. No. Today's discussion topic from my side, digital marketing, a new dimension for a startup business development, organized by Independent Perception and Research Hub, IPRS Bangladesh. This is Professor Mohammad Zahiruddin Arif, already introduced by So Shahriyar Parvez. I'm working at Jagannath University and advisor and academic council member of Global University Bangladesh, and also trustee board member, Crown University International Chartered Incorporations, Santa Cruz, Argentina, and advisory board member of Social Science and Men's Welfare Association, Jabalpur, India. Okay. If you think that we are layman in the business field, think like that, what is mean by a startup business? The term startup refers to a company in the first stage of operation. Startups are established by one or more entrepreneurs or business initiators who want to develop a product or service for which they believe there is a demand. So that means based on the demand, the initiators or entrepreneurs are trying to develop some sort of new form of business that is called a startup. For example, once upon a time in 2009, Uber Technologies, one of the most world's largest ride-sharing company, and rapidly they have developed to become the world's most valued startup. In the context of Bangladesh and South Asia, we can consider that Pathao.com is one of the follower after the Uber Technologies in Bangladesh, Pathao.com. Then another form of startup business called in supply chain or retailing hubs is website-based. Now is Chaldal.com, very popular in country Bangladesh now. And there is, in case of books and other related materials or products can be available from giving the order from rockumari.com. So in different countries, there are different sort of startup companies, especially in this digital era, focusing the digital pandemic period that have been emerged in 2020 from the March, especially from the 2019 from China. From the Wuhan state. It was earlier as a cars, but later that it has a new form of a startup business as a blessings for the business as in the digital marketing. Now, digital marketing, what is mean by digital marketing? Basically, digital marketing is the utilization of various electronic gadgets or media to promote a brand, items, service, or organization. It also uses various online channels or platforms that include email, application software, and websites. Digital marketing involves using new channels like the website, web, social media, and mobile to reach consumers, customers, stakeholders, and different kinds of business partners, including also governments and government subsidiary organizations. A shift from the traditional medium of television, radio, and print media. For example, we can consider the organizations like Alibaba.com, Amazon.com, they're the global giant in digital marketing business. Startup for business development. In the simplest term, business development can be summarized as the ideas, thinking, initiatives, and activities that help make a startup business better. As a result, startup business development includes increasing revenues, that is income, growth in terms of a startup business expansion, increasing profitability by building strategic partnerships, and making a strategic business decision in the local, global, international, global perspective. Now, five, digital marketing in business development. Digital marketing, how digital marketing can be helpful in developing a startup business, especially not only the startup, but also other business, but we'll focus on the startup business, the new form of business or new entrepreneurial business. Digital marketing, also called the online marketing, online shopping, is the promotion of brands or products to connect with potential customers, clients using the internet and other forms of digital communication. This includes not only email, social media like Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, other forms of social media platform, and also the web-based advertising, but also text and multimedia messages as a marketing channel. Digital marketing is also known as the online marketing. I've also mentioned that internet marketing, or in another term, it can be called as web-based marketing. So this type of marketing refers to any form of marketing or advertising delivered through traditional and new digital channels such as websites, social media, mobile applications, email, or search engines, among others. Types of digital marketing. Already mentioned by previous researchers in different research findings that digital marketing can be broadly divided into seven main categories, including a very popular name is SEO, search engine optimization. Through this way, through the Google searching or any other search engine, your website or page can be topper based on the application of the digital marketing practices by the third party or affiliate marketing organization. And the pay per click through this, your website or page can get the various types of customers benefit. That means the more click means more opportunity, more customer engagement, and more selling in terms of the digital marketing perspective. And the social media marketing, basically focusing on the Facebook marketing, Instagram marketing, LinkedIn marketing, and any other form of social media or platform can be applied or used for paid up marketing. And this content marketing, what type of content or material or information the marketers can develop to attract their customers worldwide in this context. And this email marketing is very popular in other world, but recently in Bangladesh, I found that many or few organizations, they have tried to email to different email ID holders to capture their position into the mind of the consumers, but sometimes they email wrongly to the wrong targeted customers. as they have no proper need of that product. And this mobile market is very popular worldwide, mobile marketing. Through the mobile, different companies provide the masses to the internet service provider, ISP provider companies. Mobile marketing can be done here. And marketing analytics also the relate to the business analytics, marketing analytics, different kinds of software can be applied to the application of the big data analysis. So these are the popular 7 categories of digital marketing practices or businesses can be done by the new form of digital marketer through their startup business. That means digital marketer can develop their business in this form of content or in this perspective. On the other hand, digital marketing can be done for any other form of traditional product-based production house and marketing companies. 4 P's of digital marketing. We know, according to the McCarthy's, 4 P's in marketing: product, price, place, that means distribution and promotion. But in case of digital marketing, the 4 P's can be connected through the 4 P terms. The new 4 P's of digital marketing is process, people, platform, and performance that offer a new ways to meet customers' needs and customize messaging for audiences that expect or aspire personalization. Feature of digital marketing in startup business. So what are the features or characteristics of digital marketing in case of a startup business? We can consider that the online marketing or digital marketing is easy to set up in case of a startup business. It's cost effective. There are no geographical boundaries, much cheaper than traditional business. There are flexible business hours. Marketing strategies are less costly. Online business receives subsidies from the government in different countries. Government provide the subsidies or support to the new startup companies, those who use the online application software and websites from their business perspective. There are few security and integrity issues. Already Dr. Ravi mentioned that the security issues is a new concern in case of the cybersecurity issues and integrity issues in case of digital marketing for a startup business. So we should consider this very considerably and with very caution and care. Digital marketing, a dimension for a startup business development. I think it's a new dimension. During this pandemic and after the pandemic, digital marketing will capture the majority market share for majority business houses of different necessary to sophisticated products and luxury items. Digital marketing transforming the time-tested interactions like direct marketing. There is no middleman. There is no wholesaler or retailer between buyers and sellers. It's direct marketing. Service and support and customer engagement easily can be done in this digital platform. The flyers in the mails have been replaced by banners. On the Facebook page and door-to-door surveys have made way for polls or voting and discussions on the website easily can be done. That cannot be done earlier in a very easy way. With cost effective way. Digital marketing and new dimension is continuous continuation of the previous slides, and various brands too are using these digital marketing frontiers for different types of engagement and messaging. Digital marketing expands the content and service types. Like the popular thing is like that, you know that in case of videos on YouTube, different kinds of posts on Twitter, and more, and might integrate on a micro site or a Facebook page. And there is the rise of digital marketing has also added a new dimension to an organizational communication. Several organizations are employing individuals or hiring agencies to cover social media marketing and online engagement apart from their regular public relations and marketing arrangements. With most global organizations, including in social media and digital marketing spectrum, this space look interesting. And the rise of services and channels should make us believe that the opportunities are endless for new form of business entrepreneurship and employment opportunity. How can digital marketing be used for startup business development? Digital marketing is an absolutely now a brilliant way to broadcast your unique selling proposition to your entire audiences, customers, and consumers. Reminded, the marketer should be broad-minded and new form of psychological minded to run and operate some sort of the business through the digital marketing. The traditional marketers or traditional knowledge providers or knowledge seekers, those who are not interested or the phobia in digital issues, they will not get the opportunity to capture the opportunity of this digital marketing for the startup business. So using blogging, web content, and social media is one of the most cost-effective ways that a brand can educate and enlighten their audiences, customers, about what it is that they do. That means marketers are doing a tremendous work through this digital marketing practice worldwide. Next, very important issue in this perspective, how do startups do digital marketing? Few best digital marketing strategies for a startup can be prescribed here. At first, you can build your website and brand. You can use social media marketing to raise brand awareness. You can use a content marketing strategy. You should start with email marketing from the very beginning. You should start advertising on Google and Facebook. You can run retargeting campaigns. That means redesign your website to target customers newly. Number seven, invest heavily in SEO, search engine optimization. So in this case, benefits of SEO for startup companies. Number one, what are the benefits can be done if we apply the invest in search engine optimization for companies' growth and development and capturing the market share in worldwide.
Sir, you have least. Last three minutes,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah. Thank you. It is going to be finished. And it helps with brand awareness and trust. It can SEO can get your traffic without having to pay the advertising bills this month. Organic traffic converts better than the any other form of traffic. That means SEO or subscription optimization is good for social media as well. SEO will guide you on creating a better website. And number six, but not the last. SEO is the key to bypass your competitors. That means you can win your competitors' position by applying the SEO efficiently, increasing your market share. How can digital business improve? How can digital marketing or business improve? The techniques we present here already are some of the best ones for boosting your digital presence quickly. Website optimization. A surprisingly high number of small businesses don't have a website. So there is the opportunity you can capture it or we can capture it. A business blog can be developed or continuously improved through the blog operation, social media, email marketing, and guest post. That means the influencer or the other important customers can post as a review post on product and services on Facebook page or group. Engage audiences with visual. These are the helpful tools to improve the business through the digital connectivity. Is digital marketing the future? Yes, the scope is wider when it comes to digital marketing. Digital marketing will remain as the most powerful way of marketing in the future. And recent observation from the different scholars in different webinar and conference that the more than 70 to 80% work can be done from home or any other places outside the organizations through the application of digital marketing and the digital platform easily to organizationals achieving the organizational goals. So no need to work in a workplace from 9 to 5 work in this way in traditional form. So we should consider the boundaryless organizations all over the world, from one country to another country, from one place to another place, from home or any other suitable places where a employee or the customer can do their work or marketer can do their marketing practices in this way. So digital marketing will remain as the most powerful way of marketing in the future. But as the dynamics of digital marketing is changing every day, a digital marketer has to be agile, alert, smart, and adapt to latest changes. Can digital marketing make you rich as a potential startup business entrepreneur? Digital marketing, yes. Digital marketing can make you or us rich if you are in tune with the changing phase of the digital marketplace. Traditional marketing such as blogging, content marketing, SEO, social media marketing, and mobile and email marketing are still solid methods of earning money online. Then digital marketing, startup business growth opportunity, according to the Google searching or observation from the Google opinion, companies that have incorporated digital marketing plans have 2.8 times higher revenue growth expectancy. It's tremendous. Companies using digital marketing have 3.3 times the probability of increasing their workforce and business. Is digital marketing good for startups? After the discussion of the different issues of digital marketing for a startup business, I think that marketing is greatly important for a startup because it is required to spread awareness regarding the business operations. As a new business, you need to educate your target clients about your products and services, and digital marketing is the way to go about it. And is digital marketing high in demand? According to LinkedIn's list of top 10 in demand jobs includes digital marketers with SEO, social media, and content marketing skills. This LinkedIn lists also digital marketing specialist among the top 10 most in demand job, with SEO being, or search engine optimization being, one of the most desired skills in near future. 10 steps to start a successful digital marketing career. Get to know the basics of digital marketing. We should know it. We should start our own websites. We can become an SEO expert after getting the few training. Get a Google advertisement certification, master Facebook advertising, ads advertising, become an expert in Google Analytics, get a digital marketing job as a freelancer, get a real internship, practical internship. In this way, we can learn it for developing our career in the near future. We can stay, or we should stay informed of new updates and keep learning. And we can learn how to use digital marketing tools. Can digital marketing work from home or anywhere? More and more businesses have the option to work remotely, and many companies do not even have an office dedicated to staff. And if we choose the freelancing route, we can work from anywhere in the world. Digital marketing professionals can expect to earn an above average salary.
Sir, last minute, sir.
And finally, thank you all. Best wishes for your peaceful, sound health during the and post worldwide COVID-19 pandemic situation. Have a nice day. If you have any question, you can raise your voice. We can share a little bit in this perspective. Thank you, IPRS, and Professor Shariar Parvez for inviting me in this August international webinar among other keynote speakers. Thank you all. Thank you, audiences. Thank you, participants, for their nice patience hearing on me and my thoughts. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. You have a deep knowledge and concept over the digital marketing, a new dimension for startup business development, and it is our opportunities that you share your thoughts by presenting this beautiful presentation. And we have our time constraint, otherwise we will listen to your presentation. I hope that in future IPRH again invite you for give your valuable speech on this forum. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Now it's a time to call our next speaker, and I would like to invite young talent academic Ravindra Thiren Vivekananda, lecturer, the Open University of Sri Lanka, research fellow of IPRH, and today he will discuss about the topic improving management skill in digital education system. So the floor is yours, sir. The floor is yours, please.
Yeah, okay. So good evening. Can you hear me?
Yes, it is clear to us, yes.
Okay, thank you very much for so wonderful introduction about me. And first of all, good evening to all. And thank you, Mr. M.S. Parvez, CEO IPRH, for inviting me this wonderful webinar to make a speech. And all the participants and all the keynote speakers, respective so people, everyone. So good evening, all of you from here in Sri Lanka. So it's a wonderful opportunity for me. So considering the time, I just want to share my slide. So can I share my slide, sir?
Yes, please. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. So is it visible?
No, it is not visible yet.
Yeah, wait a minute. Is it okay now?
Yes, it is visible now. Just slideshow, please.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yes, slideshow, please.
Yeah.
And stop the button, stop sharing.
Okay.
Just hide it. No. Just hiding button, yes.
Can you see my slide? Not yet, no?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay. Can I continue?
No, we are not able to see your slides now. Again, please.
Okay, right.
Yes.
Yeah, I think now it's okay.
Now it's okay, yes.
Okay. So thank you very much once again. I'm Mr. Ravindran Vivekanandarasa, lecturer, Faculty of Education, the Open University of Sri Lanka. So today I'm going to talk about that improving management skills in digital education system. So I think I don't tell about the digital education. Already the previous speakers have explained very clearly. So what is the digital education? Why digital education is important? You know, the time is, so we are running behind digitalization, not only education, in every aspect. Even we are bounded with digitalized. Digital concept, that's very important. So with that, you know that I just start my presentation considering the time that we are living. Now we are, you know, that 20th century, so we called information age, knowledge workers. It was knowledge based from the past century, agricultural century and industrial century. So we had that informative world. Now some people are telling that now the time is still, we are in the information age. So though we are connected with information age, we have just moved from the information age to the conceptual age. So you know that conceptual age is something different with the information. So that means the technology adaptation. You know, that just make us to be creators and emphasizers. That's the main point of this 21st century. So that's a point of this conceptual age that we are living now. So with that, you know, other thing I have to tell that we are in the fourth industrial revolution. So that is called 4IR, the cyber physical system, you know. So everything connected with cyber physical system, with computation and technology, even with artificial intelligence, we are in the 4IR. So we have to learn about this 4IR, what is 4IR. And in the time of 4IR, in the fourth industrial revolution, how the concept, technology and the digitalization is taking an important role. So that's very important here. So you know that from the first industrial revolution, second industrial revolution, and third industrial revolution, now the 21st century, we are in the fourth industrial revolution with the cyber physical system. So this will teach us this. This is clearly explaining that. So we are in the digitalization, we are in the digital world with the fourth industrial revolution concept. So I just want to tell this. Concept, I can say that concept from that World Economic Forum in 2018. So they mentioned that by the year 2025, machines will perform more traditional work tasks than humans, according to the World Economic Forum's Future of Jobs report. So what I am trying to tell here. So the machine will take everything in future. That's a concept of artificial intelligence, AI. So when the machines take all the things to perform in future, who is going to govern or who is going to manage the machines? Machine can do the work only. They can't think about, you know, that they can. There's a need for a person to manage everything. Even machines, all the activities, how we can operate the machines, how we can make it to work. with the concept artificial intelligence. That's why we are focusing on this digital skills for managers, the people who are doing and operating the things very effectively and efficiently. But when it comes to the education system, so managers mean, you know, that when we think about the school education, their principal is a manager, maybe the leader. Even teachers also, they take the role as managers when they teach lesson, when they govern the students, when they monitor the students' performance. So there are something different. There are all take the role of managing and leading and everything. No, you know that the main aspects of management. So when we think, when we go apart from the school system, that administrative side in education, there are some respective people who are taking the managerial position. They are governing the education system. They are allocating the resources. They are allocating. They are governing that how the teaching process is going. You know that in this pandemic time, the education is the only area have affected massively due to this COVID-19. So we need managers, administrators, what I'm trying to tell, administrators. Administrators also here take the role of management. So with this all concept, that's why I have here mentioned in 2025, machines will take everything to make performing everything by itself. So that's why we need good managers to operate the machines with good digital skills. So before that, now I come to my point that digital education system. You know what is digital education system? This picture will tell you what is the traditional way that we had just 2 years back or 3 years back. We were having all the traditional way of teaching method, but now we are not like, we are thinking innovatively and creatively with the digital, with the concept digitalization. We are going behind with technological tools, even in teaching, learning, administration, even everything we are thinking about the digitalization and the digital concept. That's the concept of a digital education system. So digital education is the innovative use of digital tools and technology during teaching and learning, and is often referred to technology enhanced learning, TEL, or e-learning. We can call it e-learning as e-learning also. Exploring the use of digital technologies gives educators the opportunity to design engaging learning opportunity in the courses they teach, and these can take the form of blended or fully online courses and program. You know, when it comes to teaching, there are two concepts when we use digitalization or digital tools: blended learning or fully online. So there is a concept, there is another type of online learning, supplementary. So supplementary, blended, and fully online. Blended, you know that almost each country in this world having, and they have fully adapted with the blended learning. When they have the blended learning education system in their schools or universities or any other educational institution, how they are going to manage? So what are the specific skills they need to manage this digital education system? That may be a university system or school systems or any educational institutions. So they are using different strategies, right? So that's the main point of the concept digital education system. So you know that digital transformation of education is connected with many aspects. You can read one by one. So remote protocols and video conferencing for online studies, and AR, VR for better learning experience, you know, augmented reality and virtual realities. What is augmented reality and virtual reality? You know that it takes the experience and everything practically. That's augmented reality and virtual reality. smart classroom. You know that we are running with the smart classroom. Now some students are, they are not ready to continue their education even without a smart classroom. They need some technological things, tools, and to continue their education. So adaptive learning, you know that concept, adaptive learning. AI supports. No, I mentioned that artificial intelligence. With the concept of artificial intelligence, this AI chatbots also very important for this digital transformation of education or in education. So digital transformation of education system, we have to consider the main three areas. The first one is transformation in learning environment. The second one is transformation in learning methods. The third one is transformation in teaching methods. So how the learning environment is going to be changed with the concept digitalization, how the learning methods is going to be changed, how the teaching methods are going to be changed. The main concept is here, how we are going to manage with certain skills. What are the skills? Managerial skills, even we can call the skills with management we need for governing or maybe for evaluating, for systemizing properly the digital education system, right? So elements of safe digital education system. When we think about the digital education system, so what are the safe digital elements there in digital education system? You can read one by one. The privacy management, right? How we are going to safeguard the certain things in education. Critical thinking, digital footprint management, digital empathy. How, when though we are dealing and having the digital education, so we have to respect others' feeling, even the feelings of ourselves. You know, the cyber security management, very important things. Cyber security management, cyber bullying management, screen time management, digital citizen identity. So these are the main concepts or elements of safe digital education. When we think about the managing digital education system and improving the management skills for digital education systems, we have to consider these main elements. So again, I have to mention here that digital education action plan. So you know that 2021 up to 2020, from 2021 up to 2027, the European Union has planned and introduced a digital education plan. So they have planned for only European countries, but they have just they have openly explained that it will be helpful for other countries also. They can adapt with the plan. So in future, so according to the plan, action plan, so offers, you can read this, I will just explain the one by the point one by one. Offers a long-term strategy vision for high quality, inclusive and accessible European digital education. So that's the main point. Address the challenges and opportunities of the COVID-19 pandemic, which has led to the unprecedented use of technology for education and training purposes. So like that, they have some key aspects in the action plan for a digital education system. When we think about the managing the digital education system, so we have to just go with this action plan and we have to improve our digital education system. That's the main point. You can read and you can search on Google and you can learn about this action plan for European Union for digital education system. So management skill, you know that management, normally management is something, the concept, how we are going to manage the thing or even institution or whatever the thing. So effectively and efficiently, when it comes to the education system, so there are many things how we are going to manage this digital education system, as I mentioned before. So skills, when we think about the skills, you know, there are different skills we are having and we are still developing. So hard skill, soft skills, I want to emphasize that another type of skill, go getting skills. So hard skills is connected with cognitive intelligence. You know that something we are doing practically, what we are doing physically and maybe we can directly identify and evaluate the skills. Soft skills, something related with the emotional intelligence. You can read one by one. I have given the skills also under each skill. So go-getting skill, imaginative intelligence. You know that imaginatively also, yeah, even I can tell the creative thinking like. So as managers, when we as teachers, as principals, as even administrative officers in the system of education, when we use digital education, digitalization, the concept digitalization, so we should have these types of skills. So with that, you know that there are three main types of management skills: technical skills, conceptual skills, and interpersonal skills. So with these technical skills, you know how we use the technical aspects, you know, that directly connected with the digital education system, that is technical skills. So conceptual skill, you know, these involve the skills manager presented in terms of the knowledge and ability. I explained you that we are in the conceptual world. So with that, these conceptual skills also very important. So when we think about the digital education system, how we are going to manage the education system, digital education systems with these conceptual skills. That the last one is the human and interpersonal skills. I told that the empathy, the human related empathy, how we are going to respect and how we are going to obey the feeling of others, and how we are going to take others' feeling like that. We have to just adapt it with the other people, other humans. So that's human and interpersonal skills. With these all skills, you know that in the time of IR, I told you that in the fourth industrial revolution, we have to build up some certain skills for managing digital education system. So building human capacity in science, technology, and innovation needed for regions to transform into digital and green economics and effective participation in the 4 years. So we should have analytical thinking ability, computational thinking, virtual collaborations, flexible adaptability, the ability to learn independently. So these are the skill also we have to consider when we think about this managing digital education system in this 21st century. So these are the skills and that I wanted to discuss with you, the concept digital education system and how we are managing the digital education system. First of all, we have to understand what is digital education system. And what are the skills that we should have when we manage the digital education system, not only for managers, even outside the school, when they govern some activities, resource allocation and evaluation, like not only that, even teaching and learning and even evaluation, in that kind of concepts also we have to think about this. Management skill, teacher as a manager, principal as a manager, how they are going to govern and how they are going to manage this education system with a certain skill. So with that, I sum up my presentation. Thank you very much for this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much. You have the deepest knowledge about this concept. And yes, it is really helpful for our society. And I give my heartiest thanks to you that you come to this concept in this platform. And we hope that in future you will again come in the another webinar of IPRH. Thank you so much. So
thank you.
Now is the time to call our next international speaker, Professor Dr. Mario C. Lucero, founder and chairman, Lead Philippines Global, global speaker, academician. And today, actually, sir faced some problem in his computer. So his concept is actually the digital leadership in the academy. So, sir, the floor is yours. So, if you want to discuss something about it, you can please, sir.
Yes, thank you very much, Professor Dr. Parvez, for inviting me to this platform to discuss about digital leadership in the academy. Well, it is my genuine pleasure to greet each one. Good evening to each and everyone, and thank you for inviting me as part of this momentous affair. And I have listened to a lot of speakers discussing about digital marketing, digital education, but mine is supposed to be about digital leadership, but there's something wrong with my laptop and my connection right now, so it's already almost, it's more than 10 o'clock in the evening here in the Philippines, and we cannot fix the laptop. But I would just like to share with you the concept of what digital leadership is all about. Of course, we all know about digital skills, our ICT skills, okay, in which it is very essential in leading an organization. And digital leadership would entail a lot of technical skills, particularly, of course, production of research, communication, making connections with people in order to lead a particular organization or academic institution. So leading is also managing. And that if we are equipped with digital skills, we'll be able to achieve our own goals. Of course, digitalization is different from digitization. So digitalization is a transformation of a particular skills into digital skills that would enable us to accomplish a lot of tasks. And that nowadays, for 21st century skills and 21st century learners, we have to be able to adapt to this particular kind of environment. Of course, Dr. Rabindranath had mentioned about fourth industrial revolution, which is also very important. The era of artificial intelligence, the era of augmented reality, and what we're doing nowadays, making connection with one another, is an example of digital leadership. So I hope that each of the leaders in every institution, in every organization, should be equipped with these particular skills in order to foster change and would be able to embrace new paradigms, okay? So that eventually, in the end, we'll be able to understand our mission as an academic institution, our vision as an organization. So thank you for inviting me. I hope I would be able to speak more in the future, but I'd like to congratulate you to please continue doing this. And we shall be collaborating with one another in order for us to improve the digital market in the global aspect. So thank you very much, Professor Parvez, for this invitation. Thank you
so much, sir. You will be here because you already informed me that you face a trouble in your laptop. But I said, please, sir, you just come and say something about this concept. And IPRH, thank you. From IPRH, I give you the heartiest thank. And we hope that in future, we will again get you in some future online webinar. Thank you so much. So now is the time to call our webinar chair, Advocate Rehmunnesa Begum, advocate and academician of Visakhapatnam Bar Association India and research fellow of IPRH. And today she will discuss a very vital concept related with legislation of digital marketing and her today's speech on digital marketing legal safeguard. So I'm inviting our session chair and discussant, Advocate Rehmunnesa Begum. Madam, the floor is yours. You are most welcome to our online webinar. Please, the floor is yours.
Good evening, friends. Digital trends, digital marketing issues we are talking about. And I'm really thankful to Parvez sir for giving me this extraordinary, exemplary opportunity to get connected with like-minded academicians, researchers, and good human beings. At the outset, I would like to congratulate and extend greetings on the eve of International Human Rights Day. Whether you are from Philippines, maybe you are from Bangladesh, or I am from India, we all are humans first. And second important thread which connects the identity as to the globe at large is consumers. We are consumers. So now that the topic is all about digitalization, marketing trends, whether it's an education, it's a business leadership, or maybe the agendas regarding the education facets, which right now the co-scholars, the co-researchers have rightly mentioned, the apt attention of the viewers that COVID-19, we are in a pandemic stage. It's a global pandemic, mind you, and we have to cope up with the challenges, with the new normal challenges, which we are governed by this pandemic guidelines, whether it's a national agenda or an international agenda. I think we all got connected to digitalization. Now, coming to the legal safeguards, since I'm an advocate, I would like to caution people across the globe, on the world at large, that we are on the digital era, we in the electronic era, we in this cyber world, we in this digital world, we are tend to get attracted, we are tend to get manipulated, we are tend to get focused, we are getting dubious about the various choices we have in terms of goods and services. Whether it is a necessity or it's a luxury or it's just a fascination, we are getting duped by many retailers, by many wholesalers, by many entrepreneurs, by many sellers at large. So what is that we need to understand? What is that we need to be cautious? What is that we need to pioneer is we need to be digitally safeguarded. We need to be cautious, not just with the global pandemic, C19 as such. Shadow pandemic is this digital marketing threat we have. Why I said threat is we are intricately under compulsion to buy goods and services online. As we all have witnessed during lockdown term, it was an exemplary fear that services were available online, whether it's an educational service or it's a counseling service or maybe it's a interaction with the intellectuals, or it also is about getting the medical support, medical help, and the various inventions, discoveries, and creativity taking at the global agenda. So as an advocate, I would also like to mention, apart from appreciation, apart from real appreciation from the world at large to meet this global pandemic anxiety drama and the kind of toxic news and apprehensions we have been listening to, we also got connected. Right now, this international webinar itself is a testimony that we are digitally connected. Yes, it is true. It's an appreciation. It is really a wonderful opportunity. And nevertheless, a very less economical privilege. But then when it comes to digital marketing, legal safeguards, as the topic was chosen by me or given to me or granted by IP Research Hub, I would like to tell you why these people cheat online. Is it out of need or out of greed? For some, it is need, and for majority, it is greed. Because this is a global opportunity. This is a golden opportunity for the people to get absolute benefit out of it. Absolute benefit out of it. What is that they are focusing upon? They focus upon, to cheat the people. They focus upon to get maximum out of the minimum. They tend to behave in a very inhuman way. No doubt the world at large is fearing about COVID-19, but the marketers, the business people, the covered eyes, I can say, in disguise over digitalized world, I tend to cheat people. Why this? It is greed behavior. It is a not need-based one. It is a greed-based one, right? So why do they do? Why do they do? Has several reasons. It is the money factor. It is the lucrative business opportunity. It is a competitive edge. It is the number game. It is a fascination for the unethical practices. So how we need to take a legal priority to safeguard ourselves? First, whenever you enter into any kind of a deal, whether it's a contract or an agreement or a kind of relationship, customer-seller relationship, mind you, we need to be extra cautious. We need to be extra vigilant. We need to be extra, you know, truly legally very, very, you know, a kind of in area where you need to cross-check. So how to cross-check is the cyber way, the digital way, the e-way, electronic way. Since you get connected to people in an unknown fashion and in an unknown manner. By the banners, by the flyers, by the business, you know, flyers or the cards which they float. Who knows whether it's a realistic one or it's a factual one or maybe a fabricated one. If it is a real service, we all appreciate that. But if it's fabricated one, the fake one, and it is designed only to deceive, then mind you, we need to be extra vigilant. If it is a contractual obligation, the contract itself will give you some kind of a redressal mechanism if it is done in a very lawful manner. So what I strongly advocate, being an advocate, is before entering into a contract, before entering into any kind of business, one has to be very clear as with whom you are interacting. Once you do a mistake online, it is no more a mistake. It could be a legal blunder, it could be a error, it could be a legal wrong, which could always turn up into a civil wrong, maybe a tortious liability, or even it can be extended up to criminal liability. Here in India, we have several laws governing these kind of issues. We have Consumer Protection Act, we have Indian Penal Code, also we have several civil laws. Same could be the case across the globe. Also, we do have Information Technology Act. Information Technology Act amended rules as far as digitalization and e-commerce are concerned. Also, we have Consumer Protection Act, which is a latest amendment done to facilitate the e-commerce issues. Also, we do have IPC and Evidence Act in India. Same could be the case with the foreign laws, foreign legislations also, where you need to be very cautious, as I told, when you enter into a contract, whether it's a digital contract, e-contract, or maybe a contract between the banks, a business entity, or maybe a financial entity. What is the security? What is the safety? What is the dimensions involved, people involved, the data? Especially, we sign a lot of online agreements, not knowing who is the opposite person, whether it's a real person or a fake person or someone sitting there may not be the person whom we are entering into. So it is always wise not to give all the confidential information, maybe name, identity, and probably a kind of, you know, a few details as regards to the status, nationality is okay. But when it comes to bank statements, when it comes to financial aspects, when it comes to financial issues, it is never ever wise to share passwords. It is never also advisable to give the entire entity or the real kind of information about us to the stranger. As I told you, if the stranger is a real person with whom you're entering into a contract, it's okay. If the stranger is a fabricated one, it's a fake person, it is a dubious person, it is a criminal person, is a cyber criminal, then there is every chance that you get not only trapped in their vicious circle, but you may lose your money, lose your identity, lose your emotional life, as well as you may lose into financial crunch. So these many things also have vital effect on your status and your personality as such. It could reflect on your domestic identity. It could reflect upon your family economic conditions. So better not to involve or evolve with strangers, first thing. Second thing, if the situation really demands, if the situation is really, you cannot go back, you cannot step back for any kind of, you know, necessity or maybe uncertainty or maybe emergency or maybe urgency, then you need to cross-check whether it's a realistic business offer, whether it's a dubious offer, whether it is worthy one. You have this reviews, you have this likes and comments, whether these are made by the persons they have employed or by, you know, real consumers with utmost satisfaction. So that is one agenda. And apart from that, as we have a witness to our Mohammed Zahiruddin Sahar, who has given a vast information regarding 4 P's of digital marketing. Pandemic is the most effective 5th P. We all know, I'm a student of MCOM. So while I was doing my marketing management course, we have only known about 4 P's, but now the 5th P has become the most vital P, the pandemic P. So this pandemic has not only brought us collaborations, but also hiked the cyber crimes in terms of, you know, fabrication, in terms of fake accounts, in terms of duping, in terms of cheating, in terms of, you know, creating a kind of a chaos in the global economy. Maybe one way it is advantageous, it is always a welcome sign that internationally we are getting connected. It is liberalized, privatized, globalized economy is giving the fruits to many, but there are many underprivileged people who are unable to get these fruits. So it is a sociological research what we need, and I earnestly request Parvez sir to look into these aspects where we can have a full-fledged Scopus paper to present before the globe at large, maybe in the economic forum. As such, with your international tie-ups and the kind of a collaborative research hub, you are going to create it very shortly, as I understand from your post on social media, as well as personal interaction on WhatsApp. I could strongly suggest, I think the academician should come forward with the legal fraternity to track down the various issues as far as cyber issues are concerned, data protection issues are concerned, contractual obligations are concerned, banking and insurance transactions are concerned. And finally, to sum up my session, as we are running short of time, it's already midnight for some people. So I would strongly say consumer has to be vigilant. We have a concept called as caveat emptor, let the buyer be vigilant. It is true. But what about the seller's responsibility? What about the seller's liability? What about the global treaties or global contracts and agreements which we are entering? When you are entering with a global person, why it has to be a local law? Why not be a global law, one globe, one customer kind of a policy, whereby we can be assured of getting some kind of a redressal mechanism? First of all, prevention is better than cure. Better to prevent the crime, better to prevent the digitalized, kind of cheating the consumer. If that is not possible, how to redress, how to get it, enforceable in the court of law, in a very, a single edge, in a single window concept, maybe a digitalized, enforceability. I think that will be a very glorified conclusion to have this webinar in an international platform like this. So with a hope that none of the consumers will be cheated, at least in the global pandemic times, once this becomes a habit, then again, that will become a very fruitful welcome sign for the global consumers at large. So I sincerely thank the organizers for giving me this wonderful opportunity. If there are any questions, we will look forward for that. But then I sincerely respect the independent perception and research hub for inviting us all to this platform. And let us in future work together in an academic collaboration. Thank you so very much. Khuda Hafiz. Please unmute yourself, Mr. Parvez.
Thank you so much. And you have the deepest knowledge on this concept of legislation of digital marketing era. And the point is here that one of our participants already asked one question, that what can we do when we use the apps? Because most of the organization wants our name, our email address, in fact, our mobile number. So what can we do in this digital marketing platform? Is there any safeguard system?
Yeah, definitely. Why not? First of all, do not enter into someone's domain in a very strange manner or in a very, hurried manner. First thing is that, first of all, have control on digital space. Second thing, if it is imperative, if it is uncontrollable, if it is surfing is very much required, then you have this safe apps. You can also check with your nearby cyber police. That will be an advantageous one. Suppose you don't want to take that into, because none of us, most of us may not love to go to cyber police or cross-check with that for unnecessary litigative aspects, then what you can do is trust the people, but don't be blind in trusting the people. So once you enter into an app, if you find anything which is, you know, a little bit cautious or maybe even you feel endangered with, then what you can do is go for security settings. Even that is not preventive. Better to come out of that. See, no relation or an agreement is not so very, you know, comfortable as far as your life, your privacy, or maybe your safeguardness is concerned. So first thing first is our life, our safety, our security, and our mindset, our, you know, emotional health. If that is lost, what is the fun of entering into contract with an unknown person? Of late, if you have entered by mistake or maybe by lucration or maybe by lucrative, a kind of offers or acceptance or a proposals, you can always have a remedy. As far as India is concerned, as I told you, we will definitely take this to cyber police. If there we don't get a probable answer, then judiciary is always there. So police, investigative mechanism, cyber domain, cyber security people, as well as judiciary. These are the enforceable redressal systems in India. The same could be viable in your respective countries as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Another question comes to another participant, to Professor Mohammad Jahiruddin, sir. He wants to know about that how can a woman become an entrepreneur in this platform, in this digital platform, and how can a woman will come with their facilities for digital marketing era? Sir, please unmute yourself, sir. Sir, are you asking me? Yes, sir. One of our participants actually
sound is low here, sir. Sound is low here from your side.
Okay. Now it's okay, sir.
Better. So okay. I'm audible to you.
Yes, you are audible to us. The question is here that how can a woman become an entrepreneur in the era of digital platform or digital marketing? How can they will come in this digital platform?
How can new entrepreneur can come in digital platform? Yeah.
No, a woman. Basically, it is the issue of not a man. It's the issue of woman.
Can women can come into the digital platform for their startup business? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. This is basically the positive mindset already have mentioned by different speakers in this webinar. And we found that in case of the digital phobia, the people, male or female, is very good user for, not for user in South Asia in Facebook. Very few people, or most of the people, they are involved in LinkedIn. Okay, the Facebook user in Bangladesh, India, they're not so much knowledgeable in this perspective. But in case of women, they can use it positively. The Facebook page and group, the group is one kind of strategy, and Facebook page another strategy. In case of Facebook page, the women can upload their product picture, information, and messages to inform their target customers, target people, those who have already engaged organically or by the third party organizations or agency. So in this way, the Facebook page can be helpful. On the other hand, through the Facebook group, strategically, it can be interacted among the members of that Facebook group by the women entrepreneur. basically the every women entrepreneur also need the support of the male or the family members of any houses or any family members from in case of especially South Asian countries. But the family is important thing. If the family members are not supportive, the female or women entrepreneurs will face a great challenge or problem in expanding their businesses. And if you take the different interviews from the women entrepreneur, that in every successful entrepreneur, women entrepreneur, the family members are caring and supporting, especially her brothers or sisters or husband or father, mother, or any kind of member will be helpful. But in case of women, women is not a problem here. Women is special for supporting. In every male or female, man or women, they need to learn the basic knowledge of marketing. The basic knowledge of marketing. The digital marketing is especially the extended knowledge of the traditional marketing practices. So in case of this internet and the database and analytical ability should be learned from the different sources like training, workshop, or anything else, they can improve their skills, knowledge, and abilities. And women entrepreneurs can play a vital role in digital media, especially they can get a special very good time from their home or any other places rather than any other male in case of their involvement in home affairs and social affairs. So women entrepreneurs are very vital and important maker in today's home business and homemade products. Not only that, if you get the survey in South Asian countries, Bangladesh, India, Sri Lanka, Nepal, or Pakistan, you can find that many national and multinational companies, the most probably women are the best pioneering role taker in decision making to capture the growth and market share. So I think that the women entrepreneurs can get an initiative to get the minimum training from different specialized training houses or expert people, and then they can apply and open their pages, not only the Facebook, but also in YouTube channel, also in LinkedIn, also in Twitter, also in Instagram. There are four or five platforms they can use simultaneously, multidimensionally, integratedly. Not the one page will be, or not the one platform will be much more helpful. So multidimensionally, women entrepreneur can get or capture the opportunity of the new form of market share from the different group of gender or age group.
Thank you so much, sir, for your nice
listening. Marketing knowledge is necessary, but also the branding, personal branding is important for women entrepreneur. And yes, if you found already every women, those who have the personal account in Facebook, LinkedIn, or Twitter, they are doing minimum personal branding regularly for their family members and other stakeholders, those who are involved in this Facebook group and pages and the Facebook account. So this opportunity can be helpful for them.
Yes, sir. I think our participant already understand the concept that how,
but you will have women to start. Don't be stuck on any phobia. Start on apply, and on very regular basis you will get the return or feedback, and share with the expert yes, people, those of the marketing and digital marketing knowledge.
Definitely. So, sir, actually we are at the almost end of our session. So IPRH gives the heartiest congratulations and our thanks to our today's resource speaker. You are said your perception, your thoughts on the digital marketing era, and IPRS believes that from this webinar, our participants and the viewers will learn something about this thing. And we are again give the heartiest thanks to our international participants and also our international resources speaker, and we believe that in future we will again find you in our next or in our future webinar. So we are almost actually our end of this session. So dear viewers, we are almost end of this session, and please fill up your registration form from your e-certificate. Hope that you earn something educational perception and thoughts from this webinar, because IPRH always believes that knowledge is power. Be happy, be healthy, and always join with IPRH by following our Facebook page and also subscribe our YouTube channel. Thank you.
Thank you.